Welcome to episode 5 of the Freelancing Legacy. Hey, hey, hey. I still haven't gotten into a point where I should be creating an intro for this whole thing. I don't have anything in mind, so I'm just going to say, welcome, welcome. This is your host, I'm Bernice, and like, go right to the point. Yeah. I'm going to try my best to be right to the point. Anyway, so hi. In today's episode, I'm going to start ranting about something that I feel very, very strongly about. I'm just like, every time I hear this, I get triggered, but also at the same time, I am actually disappointed that we are allowing this to happen. And this is the what we call exploitation and why I think this goes both ways. Okay, so I will be triggering a lot of things today, and hopefully, you know, you're going to take this with a grain of salt, and that if you're going to listen to this, hopefully that it's also going to open your mind into a lot of things, and that if you're going to think about the word exploitation again, you're not going to just use it to your advantage, but also think how you don't do it yourself. Okay, so first things first, what does it mean when we say exploitation? Exploitation, the action or fact of treating someone unfairly in order to benefit from their work. Number two, the action of making use of and benefiting from resources. I don't know what accent that was, but it fits. So that's the meaning of exploitation. It is treating someone unfairly in order to benefit from their work. Breathe in, breathe out. You breathe out, you sound like a cow. Anyway, so the main reason why I actually wanted to go and become a coach in freelancing is the fact that I want other Filipinos to experience the kind of life that I lived. I travel whenever I want to, go to places whenever I want to, have a hobby, whatever the hell it is, regardless if it's an expensive hobby like scuba diving or what. And basically the gist of it all is just being able to do whatever the hell I want to do. And when I started doing that, I noticed that not a lot of people actually have that pleasure, that privilege, if you will. And so I took the step to be out of the spotlight or be in the limelight and see if I can teach others how to become freelancers and see if I can actually save us, quote unquote, this is my second mission, from being exploited. Because I have been in freelancing groups, though in those days, I don't really linger on them now because, you know, I'm very sensitive with a lot of things. And so I try to like process things and try to stay away from them because mental health is of high priority to me. And so I was looking at the groups and they were saying that they were charging like $1 per hour and like really crazy amounts, you know. When I was a teacher, I was being paid, I think, 800 pesos per day. And that is how much, if I'm not mistaken, that's $16. And I thought at that time that was already really big because I was receiving $400 to $500 every month just being like a fresh graduate teacher. Okay, and I thought that was like a lot until I had to live outside of my mother's house, live by myself, and then figured that that isn't really enough. Okay, and so I started to resign. You know the story. I don't need to like repeat it over and over again. You probably are already sick of like hearing my story. I'm not assuming that everyone has actually heard the story, but if you haven't yet, you can just go check my YouTube channel. There's like a story. You know, I have a My Story video over there. My point is that, you know, I wanted other people to live the life that I got to live after being miserable for like 2 years. I was freelancing for 2 years and it was so crazy because I just cannot get a client. I was trying to be an author at the same time. And I really thought, I was like, I'm gonna have to make this book work. And like, I just wasn't sure what I was gonna publish. I just knew that I was gonna be an author, that kind of shit. So it was like, it was just so frustrating. I can still remember the feeling of like having that dread inside your heart that you're trying to achieve a dream and you don't even know where it's leading to. And then, of course, when that happened, I was very much willing to take $1 per hour, right? Like at that point in time also, my self-esteem was very, very low. And so I just keep on accepting projects or like $5 per book cover. And a book cover would take me like 8 hours to make, like an entire day. And I'm like paid only 250 pesos or $8 per hour. That is like three times less than what I was earning when I was still a teacher. So just insane. And so that's what I did. Those are the two things that really made me push through coaching. And of course, the idea that I was going to earn more was just the icing on a cake. I didn't really think that CRA was going to blow up that crazy. Like, there was no way. There was no way in the world that I was going to think like, oh, yeah, I'm going to have 5,000 students. No, I did not. There was no way. I just really didn't think that it was going to blow up. So, but those were my two main things. And every single time that I hear someone from CRA at Great Neurons Academy, one of my students, that would say something like, hey, Ms. Nemi, have you seen this post yet from this freelancing group talking about how she's just only charging blah, blah, blah. Like, people are advocating the same thing that I'm advocating, which is awesome. Like, they now understand that when it comes to exploitation, that's a no-no. You should be paid for the value that you put in your client's table, not according to where you're living. You know, these things, people understand that now. And I can't be happier, you know? But also, in that regard, I've also seen how that changed drastically. And this is why I would say exploitation goes both ways, because you can become an advocate of it. You can be like anti-exploitation, do not exploit Filipino freelancers, so and so and so and so. But then you also see your fellow Filipinos charging so low when they are actually earning 6-7 figures per month, or at least claiming that they are. And so I'm trying to think about it carefully. I'm like, is there something that I can do about this? Should I try to control the situation? And at the back of my head, it's just like, there's no way I would be able to correct this mistake. All I can really do is produce content about it in hopes that it would actually spread awareness about it. It's the same thing that I have done for years. Right? I have done that for years, talking about how, you know, like if you're a Filipino, you should be accepting this type of job, especially if you are way more valuable than that, especially if you have upskilled quite further in order to help your client have more clients, you know, these things. If you're like a key team member, if you're a valuable team member in the team, you definitely have the chance or the right to ask for a raise or whatever, right? So I'm like talking about that for years, and it has changed. Somehow, at some point, we have raised this awareness of exploitation in the Philippines, and that's really nice. There also came to a point wherein people started earning 6 figures and 7 figures per month, but are not doing the same favor to their fellow freelancers. Right now in my team, the highest that I'm paying for is $20 per hour, and I'm a Filipino. And I'm not saying this because I want to brag. You know, sometimes I'm actually, you know, when I look at people's invoices, I'm like, oh my God, this is huge, but I just need to pay them. And I am absolutely in love with the people in my team, and I feel like they're worth every penny, you know? And I would do everything to the best of my ability to make sure that if I have projects for them, I'm going to get them. And if I don't have projects, I'm going to think of something so that I can help them. And, you know, one of our team members was able to renovate his house. It's his first time charging that high, and he was able to renovate his house. He came back to his province, you know, be able to like travel and whatever. And that really makes me happy. And, you know, when you are an advocate of exploitation, not really advocate of something, but anti-exploitation, when you are an advocate of fair pay, rather, you would want to make sure that you are an advocate of it, not just because it fits you, not just because it benefits you, but because it genuinely benefits everyone. So when you say like, hey, these clients should have fair pay, you should also be an advocate of the people that you are hiring. Like, so when you hire people, make sure that you are paying them well to the best of your ability. And I get it. It's so nice to like have really huge profit margins and you don't want to pay the people that are working with you, but also you don't want to do the job yourselves, right? And that would also mean that the value that you put in the people that you are hiring isn't really that high because you are not paying them enough. Okay, that's why I said exploitation goes both ways. Another way where it goes both ways is the fact that when we talk about Filipino freelancers, a lot of foreign freelancers actually are not convinced that, I wouldn't say they're not convinced, but they're not really happy about the idea that, say for example, American clients would just go for Filipino clients because we're a lot cheaper, you know, we can do work better and whatever. And, you know, it pisses them off because of course their cost of living there is higher and us is actually lower and whatever. And then it becomes a fight of cost of living, right? So the client would somehow say, I would just get someone from the Philippines because their cost of living is lower and I can pay them lower, then try to be entitled about the Filipino freelancer's time and like not let that Filipino freelancer sleep, allow that Filipino freelancer to like work in a graveyard shift and just pay them what, $2 per hour, you know, in their graveyard shift, not having enough sleep, not having enough time for their family and whatsoever, right? So that in itself is exploitation. And I feel sorry not only for us Filipino freelancers, but also I feel sorry for the foreign freelancers that are not getting clients because of us, because we are very much willing to accept low rates. And the reason why we are very much willing to accept low rates, even though we work six times harder, is because we're desperate. But I said this once, and I think I'm gonna say it time and time again. The reason why we are accepting low rates is because we do not have the vision that we can actually change our lives, okay? My fiance, who's an American, has stayed here for 3 years, and he would always say that $400 per month for a Filipino is definitely not enough, because condominium units, being able to live in a condo, having a very, you know, comfortable life would require you to have money around, let's say, 30k to 40k per month. And so to only earn 20k per month is like nothing, right? So 20k per month would probably be, let's say, $3 per hour, $4 per hour, something like that. 10 hours a week, if I'm not mistaken, if I'm getting my math right, that's how low it is, right? It's not really helping us get into a comfortable life. So this is not even about a question of cost of living. Our cost of living might be low in some cases, like food and whatever, but it is only because we are in a tropical country, and so we have different resources than the people in the US. The people in the US also have cheaper stuff like gadgets, most especially. Their gadgets there are a lot cheaper. And then when they export that to the Philippines, then it becomes a lot more expensive. And still we pay for it, right? We pay for it still. The prices don't change, right? So it's not even a matter of cost of living or the currency of the money of the place that you're living in. It does not matter. It's the same money. It's the same price, right? Durian here in the Philippines might be cheaper. I export it to the United States. It's probably like, how much? $200. So they're paying for that too. It's still price, right? So it's just a matter of what items do we have here naturally in our country that we don't need to pay so much for, right? And what are the items that we are getting from other countries that we need to pay so much for? It's the same thing with other countries. Am I making sense right now? So it's the same amount of money, it's the same amount of currency, it's just a matter of what are our natural resources that we don't have to pay so much for, because in their country, they also have that abundance. And then when that gets exported here in the Philippines, we still need to pay for it. And so I don't think it's a matter of cost of living. It's actually a matter of what value do you put on your client's table. So I wish I can explain that better. I'm not sure if I did, but that's basically it. And then also, one more thing when it comes to exploitation and charging high. I talk about charging high a lot because I do believe that in the Philippines, we are very much composed with people that are really, really talented. Like, no question, you guys, talented, awesome, that's really good. But there are also people in the Philippines that would ask for a higher rate by doing mediocre jobs. And I'm not sure exactly how to solve that problem. I'm still thinking about it up until this day, because it's a matter of self-esteem. I would say that when it comes to self-esteem, you have to find the sweet spot, okay? You can't be too boastful, and you also can't be too negative and insecure. So there has to be a middle ground in terms of self-esteem. You can't just become too boastful and say like, hey, I should probably charge $40 per hour because I'm like this, 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 this. And then people look at your work and it's like shit. And then there's also the type of people that are so insecure that, well, I'm only charging $5 per hour. And then you look at their work and it's like, what? You've done this? That's awesome. That's crazy. You should probably charge high. So how do you find the sweet spot of not being too insecure, but also not being too prideful? Like, what's the sweet spot in between self-esteem? And here's one thing. You have to know that there's always going to be people that are greater or lesser than you in our industry, okay? And that's basically desiderata. Desiderata, the poem. You must read it. It says a lot about competition, wherein, like, you know, there's always going to be people that are greater and lesser than you are. And if you keep on thinking about that, you're going to put yourself in a nice middle ground where the sweet spot of self-esteem is. You can't be too insecure with that in your mind because you're like, oh, yeah, I might be great at some point, but also there are people that are lesser than me. So I think that I'm good in some ways. You can't also say that I'm the great, right? Because there's definitely people that are a lot greater than you. So if you're going to keep that in your head, if you're going to keep that line in your head, that's going to do wonders. Done that many times. I would always tell myself that there are people that are greater than me. That's nice. There are people that are lesser than me. And I'm here for the people that are lesser than me. I'm going to help them go up. And then for the people that are greater than me, I'm going to look at them as a mentor or an inspiration. So that's how you can find the sweet spot when it comes to self-esteem. And it's not going to happen in a snap of a finger, of course, right? So you're going to have to really redo, refine, and try to think about how you can put yourself in a middle ground where, you know, you don't exploit other people, you don't exploit yourself, right? You help other people that are in need, and at the same time serve your clients to the very best of your ability while being paid well. Alrighty, I think that's enough rant. I hope that's enough rant, and I hope that you have understand that very clearly. Yeah, this is why exploitation goes both ways. I hope that you're seeing it now from a different perspective, and I hope that when it comes a time when you're supposed to hire people, you're going to pay them to the best of your ability. Thank you so much. Till the next episode.